Y'all ready? Dangerous question to ask, I guess. What a blessing to come together this morning as his family to study, to encourage one another, and to be a part of another family reunion, and we're glad you're here today. Turn, if you will, to James chapter 5 as we continue our study. This lesson and one more will end our journey through the book of James. Paul said we still haven't determined our next study, still talking about some different things we might do after we finish this. Since we don't have a class on the 25th, we'll start the new year with a new study. We're glad you're here today. If you have any updates on the announcements, if you give those to us after class, we'll include those in the announcements at the end of worship. If you haven't, I don't know if it's in the bulletin or if you've seen it, but our internet is down, went down Friday, and it's a issue with our provider. And, they were supposed to be here Friday, and we got put back to Monday, so there's no streaming today and no internet access. The code for the PowerPoints won't work, but I don't know what the first century church did when they didn't have all these problems. I think they went right on and did what they're supposed to do, like we're going to do. But they're recording, I think, going to record the service, and it'll be posted on YouTube and Facebook and other avenues for those who are not here to be able to see it later. Everett and Ron will lead us in our devotional, and then we'll get started.
Our Father in heaven, we're truly blessed to be here this morning. We thank you for that. Thank you for another day of life that you've given us. We pray, Heavenly Father, this morning as we study from thy word, that we'll be edified and builded up in the most holy faith. Pray, Father, this morning that you'll be with Brother Doyle as he brings us a lesson. Help us, Lord, to listen in view of eternity, and help us to realize that what we hear here today are the words of the Bible that we need to heed and do thy will. Bless us throughout the rest of this day and throughout our worship service this morning, that it might be in accordance with thy holy will. In Christ's name, amen.
God and I know in the field to gather.
James, the Proverbs of the New Testament, it's been called. A very practical book written to Christians who were suffering and struggling. For a time after the establishment of the church in Acts 2, there was unity with the people and they got along well, but it wasn't long before persecution started. Here you have people who perhaps were very faithful to the Jewish nation, the Jewish ways of life, the rituals and all that that entailed. They've now professed faith in Jesus Christ, totally different perhaps way of doing things than they were accustomed to, and they're suffering. What are we going to do about it? How do we live faithfully while we're suffering? This is one of the questions James is answering. You put yourself in their place. They didn't have a complete Bible like we have to reference and turn to, and they didn't have the temple. They didn't go there anymore. They didn't offer the sacrifices. They're asked to take this on faith, and you've got people who are persecuting them, family perhaps turning against them. How do we live? How do we survive? And James is writing a very practical book to them to show them how they should still be faithful, how you can still be faithful even in the midst of persecution and suffering. It could be that they were like some who today thought, well, maybe if we just become a Christian, our problems, it'll get better. I remember a lady who was baptized many years ago, and she was very disheartened very soon after her baptism because things got worse in some ways for her, and she really struggled with that and had a difficult time. The world knows Christians are not immune to problems. We know we're not immune to problems, and we see here that these folks were being cheated by the rich landowners. They were being dragged into court. They had the normal things of life going on, plus they had this persecution. And James says from our study in verses 7 through 12, be patient. Well, that should be all there is to it, because that's pretty easy, isn't it? Just be patient, just wait. You know, just be patient, he says. Endure, continue on, don't quit. And he says you got to do that without grumbling. Now he's really meddling and making things tough. Be patient without grumbling. And don't blame your troubles on fellow Christians, verse 9. Don't curse and swear. Be patient. But what should we do? He's talking about these things we shouldn't do, but what should we do? And we come together, and I'm not going to ask if anybody's suffering today because I know the answer to that. A lot of times we feel like maybe we just live in a giant pressure cooker where we just, the pressure keeps building up and we wonder what's going to happen next and what else can happen, and we want to hit something, we want to say things we shouldn't, we want to take it out on others. But he's telling us here a scriptural way to handle the stresses of life. What's he say in verse 13? What should we do? Pray. Anybody suffering, don't complain. Pray. What do we do first? We complain. Don't curse. Pray. And there's a lot of different opinions on verses 13 through 18. There's a lot of different views on parts of what's being said here, and if we're not careful, we'll get caught up trying to figure out some of these things, and we fail to realize the main thrust of this passage is prayer. That's the main thing he's getting through. We're going to look at one of those passages where there's a lot of opinions in a moment, but don't just remember the main thing he's saying here. Prayer is mentioned 7 times in this passage that we're looking at. What, 2 lessons: whatever situation we're in, prayer is always appropriate, and prayer is powerful. That's the 2 lessons he's trying to get us to understand. We sing the song sometimes, Pray All the Time. That was written by L.O. Sanderson, a brother in Christ who's a great songwriter and song leader. Pray all the time, he says. You remember that? Pray in the morning, pray in the noontime, pray in the when you're happy, when in sorrow, pray when you're tempted. Pray all the time. And he starts off with saying, first of all, pray when you're in trouble. Is anybody suffering? Some versions have afflicted. And the word goes back to the original language here, and it means all kinds of trouble. It's an all-encompassing word. It's not just dealing with one aspect of suffering. It's the same word that's used back there in verse 10. My brethren, take the prophets who spoke in the name of the Lord as an example of suffering and patience. It's the same word, all kind of suffering. And if we went around the room here today and made a list of everything that's troubling us and bothering us and things we're suffering, there's going to be a long list. There's going to be lists with physical problems. We're going to have that on the list. There's probably going to be financial issues, job stresses, family stresses. There's going to be problems about whatever age we're in. Every age has its set of issues. Every age has its set of issues. Frustrations. There may be probably be spiritual problems, struggles with faith, guilt, things like that. And all of these are included in this word of suffering, affliction, hard experiences. And that word affliction also has to do with the result of our attitude toward these things. It has to do with a natural depression as a result of these struggles. It has to do with the problems, but also our response to these problems. It has the idea of a depression with it. We hear that word a lot. It's a common problem. There's clinical depression. There's depression that is brought on where you have to have professional treatment on an ongoing basis. And there's other depression where it's just some type of a discouragement. You have these down days and things like that. And it's common for us to get that way. But what should we do? Evidently, in some Christians in that day, were complaining. They were cursing. They were having the not a Christ-like attitude toward suffering. And again, today, perhaps our most common response is worry. Somebody said it was a bumper sticker one time. It said, "Why pray when you can worry?" That's meant to be humorous, but I'm afraid it's also sad, but true. Why pray when you can worry? The language here is let him pray. It's an ongoing, continuous action. Keep on praying. What does it mean to pray without ceasing? That's what he's saying here, that Paul said in Thessalonians. What's it mean? Does it mean never stop praying? If it does, Jesus was wrong, because in Luke chapter 11, 1, it said when he ceased praying. It says there Jesus ceased praying. Did that mean he stopped praying? Didn't mean he stopped praying. It meant he stopped at that moment in that prayer. He stopped praying, but he didn't never stop praying to the Lord. It means always have an attitude of prayer. It doesn't mean you have to have a prayer 24/7. It means always have the attitude of prayer. It means prayer should be as natural to us as breathing. It should be the first thing we think of when we're suffering and we have these problems. You remember Luke 18, the parable of the persistent widow. Then he spoke a parable to them that men always ought to always pray and never lose heart. Somebody said pray without ceasing means your amens are not periods but commas. It means there's another prayer coming. It means we're just pausing for now, but I'm going to keep praying. Prayer is not just a prescription for special, yes. Oh, okay. Okay. If I don't see your hand, yell. If I ignore you, I'm not going to call on you. Sometimes I don't see you or hear you. It's not a prescription for special occasions. It's something like our vitamin. We should take it every day to keep our spiritual health up, to keep our spiritual health what it should be. We should be ready for anything. A friend of mine told me one time, said we need to stay prayed up at all times, ready for whatever happens. That we prayer fixes our mind on the constant in a world of unconstants. Our prayer fixes us on the changeless in a world of change. We need something fixed. We need a North Star when we're suffering. We need something we can count on. That's what prayer does. It keeps us fixed on something that's going to be there regardless of what happens. James 4:14 says, we never know what tomorrow may bring. Be ready. Be strong. Be close to the one who can help us. Have that relationship be close to the one who can help us. Now, can you have a strong relationship with somebody on earth without communication? You can't do it. Same way with the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. There must be that relationship. There must be that communication. And we're going to talk in a moment why we don't pray like we should. Why do we not appreciate sometimes the blessing we have in praying to someone who listens, who understands? Hebrews 4:15-16 says, we don't have a high priest who can't sympathize with our weaknesses. You know what? In the Old Testament, if you went and talked to a high priest and you tried to talk about your suffering and he's not suffered like you have, there's only so far he can go with you in understanding how you're suffering. He can say, I'm sorry you're going through that, but I can't relate. The high priest on the earthly side and the human side was limited. He couldn't understand. He says he cannot sympathize with all our weaknesses. That high priestess has problems, sure. But he might not have had the same problem you've had. He may have not suffered, and he can't relate. But he says, we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. And because we have a high priest who understands, who knows exactly and can go the entire journey with us, he said, let us come boldly with confidence. That means, it means without shame. Let us come boldly to the throne of grace. I love that term, throne of grace, because we don't deserve it. That we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. We got a high priest who understands. He walked the earth. He was tempted like we are. He wept at the tomb. He suffered pain, physical, emotional, mental pain. He understands. He listens. He loves. God is our refuge and our strength, a very present help in trouble. Not an absentee father who sends a note and says, well, do the best you can. Work it out for yourself. He's here and he's near. I will lift up my eyes to the hills. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord. Who's the Lord? He made heaven and earth, the psalmist tells us. He will not let your foot be moved. It doesn't say you'll never suffer, but he will not allow your faith to be shaken if we will stay with him. He who keeps you will not slumber. Your friends go to sleep on you. Jesus found that out in the garden, didn't he? Family go to sleep on you. He will neither slumber nor sleep. He's your keeper, the shade on your right hand. He'll keep your going out and your coming in from this time forevermore. But things don't always go wrong. That's what we focus on. Sometimes things go right. And what does he say do when things go right, verse 13? Sing. The word cheerful means happy, full of joy, two extremes. Some of us forget to pray when we have problems. Instead of going to God, we worry. And others are quick to pray when problems come. But then we fail to pray and rejoice when things is going good. We only use God when we need him. We take advantage of him. We abuse that relationship. Pray when things go wrong. Sing when things go right. The King James says sing psalms. He's referring here to psalms of thanksgiving and praise. The New American Standard says let him sing praises. Singing has always been a natural way to show emotion, even among non-Christians. The suffering sing woes. They sing laments. Those who are happy have songs of happiness that reveal the heart. Singing has always been a vital part of Christian worship. And James is saying here, again, just as we keep on praying, he says, keep on singing. We know the passage speaking to one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord. We stop right there. What's the next verse say? Giving thanks. In that singing, always for all things to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. We sing to one another songs of encouragement, things to build us up, teaching, and we sing songs to God, praise songs to God. But he's saying here, when you're happy, let your minds be turned to God. What do we do when things are going well? Well, let's go out and celebrate. Let's go out and have a dinner. Let's have a party. Let's have a get-together. Let's celebrate the good news. Great, let's do that. But our mind should turn first to where? The God who the giver of all that's good. There's nothing wrong with doing those things, but there's other ways to express our happiness, and we should praise the one from whom, again, all good things come from. He says, let him sing psalms. This is not in the context here of the worship service. This is you and I expressing from our heart on Monday, on Tuesday night, Wednesday morning, throughout the week, throughout our life. He's talking about singing. It comes from a response of a heart who is thankful, who realized where the true blessings come from. He doesn't say, do you sing well? He doesn't sing, do you say, do you like to sing? Any singing directed to God in praise is beautiful, regardless of how it sounds to the human ear. Thankfully, God's ear is different than ours. He doesn't hear keys. He didn't hear timing. He doesn't hear chords. God hears hearts. Sing. Sing. It is good to give thanks to the Lord, the psalmist said, and to sing praises to your name most high, to declare your loving kindness in the morning and your faithfulness every night. Psalm 96, oh, sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord all the earth. Sing to the Lord, bless his name. Proclaim the good news of his salvation from day to day. I will sing of mercy and justice, David said. It's good to sing praises to our God. It's pleasant and praise is beautiful. These are not exclusive commands. Sometimes we can sing. We need to sing when our heart's broken. Sing laments. Sing songs of crying out to God. We show God how much we love him when we sing. It helps our heart. It's good therapy for our hearts. But you know what? What do people think when they hear us singing? Well, sometimes they may say, well, they can't sing a lick. Go back to Acts 16. Who was in prison? Who, Peter and Silas, was it? Huh? I got that wrong. Paul and Silas. I knew that didn't sound right. They're in prison. You may think, well, that's not too good a place to be. They could be happy because their life was spared. There could be a cheerfulness going on. Well, what were they doing in prison? And after that, what's it say? What? The prisoners. People were listening. People were listening. You ever thought if you're going through the store or somewhere and you're just kind of singing, you don't have to sing loud, just kind of singing a praise song. That preaches a pretty good sermon to those around us. They hear us singing, and it may start a conversation. Who knows? Pray, sing. Verse 14, passage that creates a lot of questions. Is anyone among you sick? Call for the elders of the church. Let them pray over him. Anoint them with oil in the name of the Lord. A lot of different opinions on this. I'm going to give you my opinion. Questions are in this passage, is he dealing with spiritual sickness or physical? Is the oil medicinal or symbolic? Is this healing he talks about providential or is it miraculous? Is the healing spiritual or physical? You get that figured out, you'll understand the passage. A lot of questions, not a lot of information here to answer a lot of these specifically. Again, there's opinions all over the place, even in the brotherhood. There are opinions about this. We know that in the first century, some were given the gift of healing. He says, call for the elders. Not all elders had that gift. Can't say that all of them had it. We're not told they had it. Don't know here a lot of different questions, again, about this. But he said, call the elders, first of all, because they are supposed to be the spiritual leaders. They're supposed to be the ones who you would look to for comfort and help in times like these. So he says, call for the elders. Of the church. some believe the different views on this are that it's all spiritual. There's no physical sickness here. I don't believe that. I believe he's talking about physical sickness because he deals with spiritual a little later. Oil could be used, and they went about healing and anointing with oil. The implication is that oil was used for miraculous, but is also symbolic of God's approval. Oil is used as symbolizing God's presence and his approval. What do y'all think it means? Before I tell you what I think. Okay. Good Samaritan was oil for healing. Exactly. Paul said we know sin can cause sickness, and that is true. There are some things we can do to cause harm to the body that creates sickness, and he says here if he has sinned, that is also taken into account. Also, we also know that oil was used in Mary anointing Jesus' feet symbolically. So he doesn't define, is it symbolic? Is it miraculous? A lot of things hanging out there that we can't say for definitive here. There's room for some opinion, in my opinion. I have known of this happening, of elders in the church in recent times doing this. If I was an elder and a member asked me to do this, I would be hard-pressed to refuse that request. I believe it can be a symbolic act of love, compassion, that God is listening, he is with you. It can be a sign of comfort that he's hearing our prayers. It's nothing to do with miraculous, nothing miraculous about it. I believe it can be done in that sense. Again, that's my opinion. I respect others who have different opinions. I know of people who have had this done who talk about how refreshing and how it has made them feel at peace with God hearing their prayers. Somebody showing this act in a visible way that they care. Again, that's my opinion. I certainly believe there's room for that. There's others who says it just strictly has to do with that day and time, and I respect that opinion as well. I don't think there's enough here that we can be binding in our opinions on this and make it a test of fellowship in whichever view you have. The main thing, again, to consider in this passage is if you got problems, pray, and don't be afraid to ask others, the elders. Now, my version says if it's a nice, pretty day and the sun is shining, call the preacher. But if it's at night and it's cold and it's bad weather and the roads are slick, call the elders. I don't know what your version says, but it says call the elders. I don't mind people calling me. Understand that. I'm honored when people call me. But it says call the elders. Elders have a role here in ministering during these times. They are spiritual leaders. They're to be there. Why do you call them? They're to be, again, shepherds, shepherding. They have a ministry here in this. Again, don't misunderstand me. I'm not saying don't call me. Call the elders. Call the elders, and it says here, call them and ask them to pray for you. That's to me, if you don't get anything else out of this and don't want to get into all that study about what that means, again, the subject is prayer. Pray and ask the elders. Ask others. Sometimes we're free to ask for prayers. And again, we're talking here about sickness. We're going to talk about the sin in a moment. But ask for prayer. Pray, pray, pray. That's the message. Your questions, your comments. Mm-hmm. Exactly. That's what we're getting into.
Not taking away anything from prayer or
Exactly.
And that meeting with the elders and that prayer, the effective prayer, is uplifting.
That's right.
In so many ways that we don't know, but we do know that God forgives.
Absolutely. He's going to talk about that. If this was an absolute command, these people would still be alive, wouldn't they? I'm sorry.
It would mention it.
It would be commanded. Exactly. Exactly. And it's not commanded, not required anywhere else. That's why we leave that open for the thing of judgment. And then going into what Mark says, let's look at that. And if he has committed sins, he will be forgiven. Spiritual health is what he's just saying is much more important than the physical. And it could be that this is a situation where somebody's sick and there's also spiritual issues involved here as well. That there's healing needed primarily for things spiritual, but also for physical. But he's saying here to take care of all of it. And again, it could be some connection between this specific situation he's talking about, between the sickness and the sin. Again, you go back to John 9. The apostles made that mistake thinking all sickness and sin was connected, and they said this about the man who had been blind from birth. Who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? Jesus said neither this man nor his parents sinned. So he said there that he was blind, but it wasn't a result of sin in that situation. Certainly at times it is. There's connections, but at times there's not. And he's saying here, how do you handle the sin sickness? You pray. What was Peter tell the Simon the sorcerer in Acts chapter 8 who had become a Christian and then he tried to buy the gifts? What was he told to do? Pray. Pray therefore, repent that this, repent therefore this your sickness and pray God. He's going to talk about verse 14, pray for one another, confess your sins to one another, pray for one another, confess your trespasses, pray for one another that you may be healed. Healed is used, again, Mark's saying here, it's used in the physical sense and it's also used in the spiritual sense. The wise man said in Proverbs 28:13, he who covers his sins will not prosper, but whoever confesses and forsakes them will have mercy. If we confess our sins, 1 John 1:7-8-9 says, he's faithful and just to forgive us. Philip said you should get in the habit of admitting your sins one to another, confessing sins to one another. Confession is good for the soul. Pray for one another. Pray for one another, but I have to confess my sins and ask God for forgiveness myself. But he says here we're to confess our sins. This brings in the idea of accountability in the Christian life. Confess specific sins. Sometimes people will know they have committed a sin against a person, and they'll come forward and say, well, if I've harmed anybody, it's not the way you handle that. You go to that person. You deal with it with that person. There's time for public confession. There's time for private confession. Repentance. He says here in Matthew 5, if you've got a problem with somebody, go settle it. Don't even come to worship. You go take care of it with your brother first, and then come talk to your brother before you talk to me. Jesus said, if I've sinned against someone, take care of it with them. Sometimes there's a time for public confession. The question is asked often, should I go forward? Confession should be as public as the sin. That's kind of a general rule. If something has been done, the congregation knows about it, and it's a public situation, public confession's called for. If that's between you and God, no need to bring it before the congregation. If it's between you and one person, two people, or four, deal with it within that group. Confession should be as public as the sin, is what he's saying, I believe. But we have this accountability where he's saying here, confess to one another. Admit, I've struggled. I've got problems. I'm sinning. I need your help. I need you to be accountable, accountability partner with me. There's people who I know have who have traveled, and because their job, they travel a lot, and they stay in motel rooms. And by doing so, they get hooked on watching things on TV they shouldn't watch. It becomes an addiction. They're there alone in a place they don't know anybody. And these people sometimes will have an accountability partner. So I need you to check on me. I need to be able to call you when I'm struggling. I want you to ask me when this trip is over how I did. Accountability. Bear one another's burdens and so fulfill the law of Christ. He says, pray for one another that you be healed. I think he's speaking here of the spiritual healing. Pray for one another, which is more important. Healing is used in this context in Jeremiah 3:22. Return, you backsliding children, and I will heal your backsliding. He's saying there, healing in the spiritual sense. Again, the whole message throughout this passage, pray. Pray for one another here. And then there's power in prayer because the effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much, James 5:16. That's an amazing statement on the power of prayer. Notice what he says here. The person whose prayer is powerful is what? Righteous. Doesn't say they have to be a church leader. Doesn't say they have to be somebody well known. Philip said the prayer of a good man. You don't have to pray eloquent prayers for God to hear your prayer. You don't have to know a bunch of scholarly, theological concepts, phrases, and words. But to be righteous, for your prayers to be powerful. What kind of praying? Fervent, intense, earnest. He's saying be serious about praying. It's not something to play around with. How much potential does prayer have? Effectual. That word effectual there is where we get our English word energy. Means it's energizing. Your vehicle's not going to run without fuel. We can't run without spiritual fuel. We can't run without prayer. It leads to an energized life. And then he said it avails much. It comes to the word, it means strong. It's powerful. Has great power or tremendous power. God works when we pray. I don't know that we believe that. God is still working, even as we have the full revelation of God and miracles, see the cessation of miracles. Sometimes I think we believe God's quit working. He's still working. If you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father who is in heaven give good things to those who ask him? And then just so he wants to prove his point here, and James is saying, well, in case you're wondering if what I'm saying is true, let me tell you about a man named Elijah. He was a man with a nature like ours. He prayed earnestly. It would not rain. Didn't rain for how long? 3 years and 6 months. He prayed again, and it rained. The earth produced fruit. Comes 1 Kings 17 and 18. The power of prayer. Somebody said, well, I don't see how that can be a parallel to me because look at Elijah. He was one of God's favorites. He was an awesome man, but James knew by the Holy Spirit inspiring him that we would probably say something like that. And what's he say? He was a man with a nature like ours. What's he saying? He said, he's just like you. If you think this doesn't apply to you, he's just like you. He wasn't perfect. He was a good man, but he had his weakness as well. 1 Kings 18, what happens? He wins a great battle with the prophets of Baal on Mount Carmel. Read the next chapter. He wants to die. He's so depressed and discouraged, God, take my life. He's just like us. But God heard him because, number one, he was a righteous man. Doesn't say he was perfect. He was righteous. Number two, he prayed earnestly, fervently. Number three, the prayer is he really prayed. The phrase here, fervently, earnestly, is he prayed with prayer. He prayed prayer. He prayed earnestly that it might not rain, and it didn't rain. And he prayed again, and it did. There's all kind of examples in the Bible of that, but for some reason, James said, this is the example I want to show you to prove that it works. What's the number one reason we don't pray? Why do you think the number one reason is we don't pray? Again, opinion. We don't study enough, Miss Rudy. Don't believe it's God's going to answer. What else? Lack of faith. What else? Don't concentrate enough on prayer to do it. Not a priority. What else? Somebody said something. Busy. I think one of the main reasons we don't pray is because we're trusting self instead of God. I can do this. I can figure it out. I can handle it. I think that's it. And I think it's tied directly to the lack of faith.
It's kind of like until there's no other
option. Until there's no other option. Little boy's out in the yard trying to move a big boulder out of his playground that he was moving dirt around and found this big rock. Dad's in the house watching him. Can't move it. And dad finally goes out, and the little boy's just mad, frustrated, and tired, and done everything else. He said, "What's the problem?" He said, I can't move this rock out of the way. "Have you done everything you can do?" He said, "I've done everything I can do." "You used all your strength?" "Yeah." He said, "You hadn't done everything you can do. You hadn't asked me to help." We expend our energy on trying to move those boulders, wear ourselves out, get frustrated, say and do things we shouldn't. And as Paul says, when we're flat on our back, then we finally remember, oh yeah, God. If we'd have been praying instead of sleeping, the rock might not have been there in the first place. Other comments or questions? That's right. Sometimes the answer, Paul says, he prayed three times for the removal of the thorn in the flesh. And what did God say? "My grace is sufficient for you." And let's be careful about using the phrase, "Well, God answered my prayer." When do we use that? When we got a yes. Did he answer it when you got a no? Let's be careful. I appreciate that. But God answers our prayer. When the timing is not right, he says slow. When we're not right, he says you need to grow. When it's against his will, he says no. And when all is right, he says go. He's going to answer one way or the other. Let's pray. Father, you're listening. Forgive us for taking that for granted. And forgive us for using prayer as last resort. And forgive us for having more faith in ourselves than we do you. Forgive us for not communicating with you as you desire. Remind us to pray as James has described. Help us to live lives that will cause our prayers to be heard. And we understand we can't be perfect, but we can be righteous. Help us to prioritize prayer, to pray earnestly, to not be so busy we can't talk to our Father. And we thank you for every answer of every prayer, for you see beyond the horizon and you know what's best for us and for your glory. Help us to still have faith when you say no and to wait. Help us to use those times to grow closer to you and to be thankful for every answer of every prayer. As we go into this time of worship, may we worship you as the Father who loves us and has given his Son for us and the giver of all that's good. And may all that we do is in accordance with your will. And may we live lives this week that those around us will know that we've been in your presence today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.